verse 13 that says, when we seek the Lord wholeheartedly, we will find him. As we were singing and declaring those words, I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I remember a time this week, my own personal time of prayer and worship, I was feeling super overwhelmed. What I realized is that just being in the presence of God, it didn't necessarily give me an answer, but when I sought the Lord wholeheartedly, he met me right where I was, and he washed all my anxiety, all the fear, everything I was like, he washed it away. You may feel like you need an answer. You may feel like you need something this morning. Can I remind you, what you need is Jesus. What you need is his presence. And when we seek him wholeheartedly, as Jeremiah 29 says, when we seek him wholeheartedly, we will find him. He says, you will find me, says the Lord. So all across this place, I just want to encourage us this morning. Don't seek an answer, seek Jesus. So when we seek an answer, we may not find it, but when we seek Jesus wholeheartedly, we find him. He washes over us in his presence. So if you're carrying something, maybe like me today, a little overwhelmed, just seek Jesus and watch as his presence washes over us this morning and just wipes that away. Amen. Lord, we seek you wholeheartedly in this place. Through our worship, we seek you wholeheartedly, giving you the praise and the honor, the glory you're due. We will experience your presence today. We will experience your peace today as we worship and encounter your spirit, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Your name.
times I've walked into moments like this and I've been asking for an answer, but really I just needed the presence of God. Maybe you're here today and you've never lifted your hands in worship, or maybe you've never encountered the Holy Spirit. He's here today and He wants to speak to you. He wants to encourage you. He wants to remind you you've never walked alone. You're never going to walk alone. And when you set Jesus above everything else, things in your life begin to take shape and things in your life begin to move. And I want to encourage you today. Maybe you're here and you're facing anxiety or depression. I want to encourage you to lift your hands and to place Jesus above that today. Maybe you're here today and you're facing financial lack, or there's something in your life you need to make a decision on. I want you to put Jesus above that. Maybe you're here and you've got marriage tension or relational tension in your family. If you put Jesus above that, He's going to bring comfort and peace right in the middle of it. So God, I don't know what every person in the room is facing, but I've seen in my life time and time again that where your presence is, the joy of the Lord is. Where your presence is, there is peace. Where your presence is, there is hope. And today we put you above everything else. We put you above the name of anxiety and depression. We put you above the name of fear. We put you above the name of divorce. And we worship your name alone. And we may be facing something significant, but there is no name like Jesus. So we worship you today. We give all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. The church said, amen. I love it. No place I'd rather be than with you guys right here on a Sunday morning. Hey, why don't you turn to one or two people, give them a high five, and you can grab your seats today.
Giving today, I love that in this season as a church, we decided to do Dollar Club right here in the middle
those same people who just a few days later crucified Jesus. What they're doing in this moment is they're worshiping. They're saying, Hosanna. And that word actually means save us. It means this is the Messiah, the one that we've been waiting for, who's going to free us from the tyranny of the Roman Empire. You see, they were worshiping and giving in that moment because they knew that Jesus was there to save them. What they didn't know is that Jesus was not just going to save them from the Roman Empire. He was going to save them from sin, hell, death, and the grave, and give them eternal life. You and I know that today. They didn't know that Jesus was going to die and come back from the dead. Still, they were worshiping and they were giving. They were laying down palm fronds. They were throwing offerings in front of him as he rode into the city. They didn't know what you and I know today. How much more should you and I be willing to give? Because we know that he's not here to save us from an earthly person in the Roman Empire, but instead, he gave us eternal hope and salvation. For us, every time that we gather, every time that we step into a moment like this, we're giving out of worship. We're giving out of gratitude, saying, Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for what you did for me. Thank you that you didn't leave me on my own, but you came after me. And time and time and time again, because of that, he's worthy of not only my worship with my hands and my mouth, but also the worship of what he's provided in my life. I want to encourage you to take a step today to give. Maybe you've never given at Christ Fellowship. This is a safe place to do that. We're here, again, like I said a few minutes ago, doing Dollar Club. You don't know what that is. Dollar Club is all of us are going to give $1, or maybe it's $5 or $10 or $20 or $50 for you. We're going to give $1 all to make an impact in somebody's life. Maybe today that's your first step, is to give to the Dollar Club to see what God is going to do. And I want to have our host come forward now as we're preparing to give. And I want to pray for us, and then we're going to see a video together of the impact that we've made, not only in the past couple of years, but every time that we've done Dollar Club. So a couple ways you can give here at Christ Fellowship. You can text the word info to 441-441. As we pass buckets this morning, you can give that way as well. The white bucket would be the Dollar Club. The black bucket would be for general tithes and offerings. God, thank you so much that you did not leave us on our own, but on Palm Sunday, you rode into the city, God, seeking your people. God, you knew they would crucify you, but still in your grace and your mercy, you had compassion on them. You still gave your life for them. We're grateful today because of that, God. We're not only going to give our praise and our worship, we're going to give out the provision and given for us as well. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Hey, as we pass the buckets this morning, I want you to see a few stories that you and I have been able to be together.
We all gave $1 above a regular giving. $1. God, that's something exceptional to God. Thank you. Today happens to be one of my favorite Sundays that we have as a church. It's a very significant Sunday, not just in the life of our church, but in the life of the church around the world, because today is the beginning of Holy Week. It is the beginning of a time where we stop and remember the amazing grace and incredible love that God has poured out on our lives. It's a week that leads us up to the cross. It's a week where people all around the world are going to stop and remember and reflect on the goodness of God displayed through Jesus Christ. And you've heard me say before that I really think that every week ought to be Holy Week. I think that every week we should live our lives mindful of the sacrifice of Jesus, the love of God, the goodness of God, because here's what I know. When I live my life mindful of his death, it changes the way I live my life. When you live your life this week mindful of the sacrifice and the death of Jesus, I guarantee you it's going to change the way you live your life. Holy Week. Holy Week begins by what we call the triumphal entry. Jesus riding into Jerusalem on the back of a lowly donkey. And many times we move past this part of the story to get on to the rest of the story of the week. But really what happens on this triumphal entry is quite significant. It takes place on the week of the beginning of Passover, where there literally would have been tens of thousands of Jewish families that would have gathered in the city of Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. Now, Passover is a feast that points back to a time in the life of the Israelites when they were in captivity in Egypt, and the plagues were taking place, and it's God that passed over the homes of the Israelites that had the blood of a lamb across the doorposts of their home and spared their lives. So they were there in Jerusalem getting ready to celebrate the sacrifice of a lamb and the mercy of our God. Let that sink in. On this Holy Week, they were celebrating, preparing to celebrate, the sacrifice of a lamb and the mercy of our God. And in the book of Exodus chapter 12, Scripture is very clear about how to prepare for Passover. In fact, it tells us there that the Jewish fathers were to select a spotless, pure lamb that would be sacrificed. And they were to do it on the 10th day of the first month, 4 days before the sacrifice would actually be made. And according to the Gospel of John, and John's timeline, it was this day, this Sunday Jesus entered Jerusalem, that was exactly the 10th day of the first month. So when all the Jewish fathers were selecting a spotless, pure lamb that would be sacrificed, our Heavenly Father was presenting his spotless lamb that would be sacrificed for our sins. Isn't it beautiful just the intricacies of Scripture that point us to who Jesus really is? And so as Jesus entered that day on the back of a donkey, the people, they were lining the streets, and they were shouting, and they were waving palm branches, and they were shouting, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna!" I mean, the palm branch was actually a symbol of victory. It would often be waved when a conquering hero or king would come back in after victory. He'd say, "Well, we're saved, right? Hosanna, right?" That word Hosanna actually means "save us now. We need saving." They had no idea what they were shouting that day as they shouted, "Save us now. We need saving." They thought they needed saving from the Romans. They thought that Rome was their enemy, but in actuality, they had a much greater enemy. That's right. Jesus didn't come to give them political freedom. He came to give them spiritual freedom. Yeah. He didn't come to relieve some momentary problem that they might be going through, but actually to deal with a sin nature problem, a separation from God problem. That's what he came to save them. They needed saving, all right. They just didn't know what they needed saving. A lot of times we don't realize what we need saving from. Come suddenly reminds us what we need saving from. So Jesus comes riding in on this donkey, and It says in the verses leading up to the triumphal entry in Matthew chapter 21, Jesus tells him where to go and find this donkey. He says, go into the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey that is tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. And if anybody says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them and will send them right away or send them back. And that part of the story is always, as I remember as a kid, that kind of jumped out to me. That these two disciples are going to go into some random town to some random guy and take his donkey, right? I'm like, wait, how did that happen? And we don't know if the man maybe had a vision, an angelic visitation, and said, Jesus is going to need your donkey. Or maybe he was just a generous guy. But either way, he lets the disciples untie the donkey so that Jesus could ride into Jerusalem and actually fulfill prophecy. Hundreds of years earlier, the prophet Zechariah, in Zechariah 9, prophesied about the coming Messiah, and it says, see your king coming right into you victorious but lowly on the back of a donkey. So we don't even know this man's name that gave the donkey. He gets no recognition for his donation. But his generosity fulfills prophecy. His generosity actually carries Jesus to his destiny. Right? And it's used by God. Something as simple as a donkey carried the message of salvation to people, which has told me, and I've shared this before, you don't need a stable of stallions to do something great for God. A lot of people think, oh, I'll do that when I got. No. All you need is a donkey and a generous heart. And you can be written into the greatest story ever told. This donkey becomes one of the main characters in Holy Week. Yeah, because of his generosity. See, when we're generous with our stuff, we get to be a part of God's story. But that's another sermon for another day. So Jesus would spend the next few days in and around Jerusalem with his disciples. He spent time staying at the home of Lazarus and Mary and Martha. He went off to the Mount of Olives to pray a few times. And then on Thursday, he would make his way with his disciples to an upper room, where they would actually share in the Passover meal together. Like I said, this meal was to mark the sacrifice of a lamb and the mercy of God. And Jesus would use this meal to actually teach us again about the sacrifice of a lamb and the mercy of our God. We call it the Lord's Supper. And we have shared many, many times at Christ Fellowship about the significance of the Lord's Supper. How the bread, when Jesus took it, he said, this bread represents my body that is going to be broken for you so that you can be whole and put back together again. And this cup of wine, it represents my blood that is going to be poured out for your sins. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. But that's not the only thing that took place that night in the upper room. There was another event that took place that John records in John 13. It says this, Jesus and his disciples were sharing the evening meal, so they were eating. The devil had already provoked Judas, Simon Iscariot's son, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew the Father had given everything into his hands and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got from the table, he took off his robe, picked up a linen towel, he tied it around his waist, and he poured water into a wash basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that he was wearing. A couple things to remember about this is back in the day of Jesus, people walked around everywhere in open sandal shoes in dirty, dusty streets, mud, that they shared with animals. So there was all sorts of nasty all on their feet, right? And so when they went into somebody's home, there would be someone there to wash the feet because the tables were not high like this table. They would gather the table much lower to the ground, so they couldn't hide their feet under the table. Their feet would be right next to them and next to the person next to them, and so that was nasty. And so there would always be somebody at the door when you went into someone's home so that they would wash your feet. It was usually reserved for the lowest servant in the household, right? Because nobody wanted to touch the nasty feet. But that day when they went to the upper room, nobody washed nobody's feet. They all got there, and there was a basin and towel, obviously. We just read that there was. But that night, nobody thought it was their job to wash anybody's feet. Obviously, they and they all thought it was beneath them. Obviously, they were looking for the best seat at the table. When they get close to Jesus, when the closest thing to Jesus is serving the way Jesus serves. So Jesus uses this opportunity to actually teach them a lesson. And I believe to teach us a lesson as well. In fact, it would be one of his final lessons, because this was some of the final moments he would spend with his disciples. In just a few hours, he would be taken away from them. So you would think this would be like a grand finale lesson. Like, let's have a mind-blowing miracle, Jesus. Let's raise somebody from the dead. Let's zap somebody and raise them from the dead. Let's turn the wine back into water. What do you want to teach us? No, he actually says, I want to wash your feet. And so he gets up and he takes that basin and that towel and he pours the water and he begins to wash their feet. And he doesn't just wash some of their feet. He washes everybody's feet. He washes Peter's feet. Peter's going to deny him in just a few hours. He washes the disciples' feet that are going to desert him. He even washes Judas's feet, who betrays him. Now, it is one thing to wash the feet of somebody you love, right? Like, I don't even like to massage Judas's feet. I do, but after about 2 or 3 minutes, I'm like, I'm done. Move on. But to wash the feet of somebody who's betrayed you, who's hurt you, who's used you, what kind of love does it take to wash your betrayer's feet? What kind of Savior do we have that actually will feed his Judas and then wash his Judas' feet? We don't treat our Judas that way. Man, we give our Judases the cold shoulder. Little snake eyes. We want to treat them the way they deserve to be treated, right? That's how we think we should treat our Judas. Wash the feet, not a chance. But Jesus is actually, in one of his final lessons, reminding us how to love our enemies. How to trust God. See, part of this had to be, of course, that Jesus, knowing all things, knew that this was a part of God's plan. That God was actually going to use a hard place and hard people in our lives to usher us into his purpose. He would have known the truth that the Apostle Paul would later declare in Romans 8:28 that we know that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purposes. He would have known that truth. He would have known that God is in control even when your enemy is seated at the table. He would have known. So Jesus, knowing this, sets aside his garments and washes their feet. And he waited. They were already eating the evening meal. Why did he wait? Was he waiting to see if somebody would get a clue? Was he waiting maybe to just remind us that it's never too late to let Jesus wash away the dirt from your life? No matter how dirty your feet have become, no matter how long it's been on there, no matter what you've walked through, it's never too late. Aren't you thankful? To let Jesus wash away the dirt and the shame from our lives. And some of you today, as we make our way to the crosses in a little bit, you're going to let Jesus do that. Well, after they had the time of the evening meal, they would have gotten from the table, and they would have made their way to the Garden of Gethsemane. Gethsemane is on the Mount of Olives, and that word Gethsemane is made up of two words, gat, which means the place of the pressing, and shemanim, which means oil. And so in the Garden of Gethsemane, there are olive trees everywhere. There would have been an olive press, which is this huge, heavy stone weight that presses down on the olives to get the olive oil and the juice out of the olives. And when you read the story in the Garden of Gethsemane, you know Jesus had his disciples. He says, "Watch and pray," and then he would go off and pray, and he would come back and find them asleep. And three times he would do this. He would go off and pray, and three times he would pray the prayer, "Father, if there's any other way for this to happen, let this cup pass from me. I don't want to go through with this, but not my will, your will be done." When he was praying that prayer, it wasn't because he was afraid to die. He knew that he would live again. He knew that he would rise again. What he was praying was, God, I don't want to, Father, I don't want to take upon myself all the sin of the world, all the shame of the world. And think about it. He who was without sin was going to become sin so that we could be made right with God. He was going to take upon himself every evil deed, evil thought, every horrific, perverse action that would ever take place. He was going to weigh, it was going to weigh down on him. It was going to press down on him. And he's in the place of the pressing, the Garden of Gethsemane, when this happens. You might remember we shared before that in the olive pressing, there are three presses of the olive. The first pressing, when it goes under the big crushing weight of the stone, is first to get the olive oil out. And that oil was used not for necessarily cooking, but it was used for lamps and lighting the way for people to see in the homes. But then they would take that olive and continue to press down on the olives. And the next substance was a little bit thicker. And it was like a solvent for wounds, for healing. It was used to heal. But then they weren't done. There was a third pressing of the olive. And then it would make more of a pasty, thick substance that would be used to make soap for cleansing. Three times Jesus was pressed. Three times he went away and he cried out in great anguish. Three times he was pressed under the weight of sin. And you see the significance. He was pressed to become our light, the light of the world, to help us to see how to go and how to live. He was pressed for our healing, that by his stripes we would be made healed, whole, and he was pressed for our cleansing. That he and he alone cleanses us from our sin and washes us clean. One last thought from the Garden of Gethsemane that we read in Luke's account is found in chapter 22. Luke says, "And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground." Now, you have to remember that Luke was a physician, right? So when he records things, he's recording it from his gifting and his calling. And he talks about this anguish, that such agony that his sweat became like drops of blood. But when you read the original text, the word "like" is not there. Wow. And so it would actually translate, his sweat became drops of blood. And Luke is actually describing a rare medical condition, hemophidrosis, where actually the capillaries in your sweat glands under such pressure will actually burst and mix with the sweat and force its way through the skin. That's what was happening in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, before he ever even made his way to the cross, was shedding his blood for us. He was beginning the atonement for our sin. The sacrifice began. And while he was praying, Jesus led the soldiers to the garden. They arrested Jesus. They dragged him before the Jewish leaders and Pontius Pilate, set up a mock trial, and they began to beat Jesus to the point of death, and then made him carry his cross through the streets of Jerusalem towards Calvary. But the truth is, it wasn't his cross. It was my cross. It was your cross that he carried that day out of love for us. Would you pray with me? Jesus, today we are just reminded of your amazing grace and love in our lives, and we thank you for the way you love us so completely, that you would take upon yourself our sin and our suffering. We can't even imagine this kind of love. We can't imagine this kind of God that would love us so completely, but today we are thankful and grateful for your love and your mercy.
Thank you. faced in the garden preparing himself for this moment. The cross. I don't know why Jesus chose to come at the time in history when he did, but he chose the moment when the Romans had perfected the art of execution. They had perfected this thing called the cross, which was something that would be hung on the outskirts of the city for the lowest of the low, for those who had committed the most heinous crime. It was excruciating. It was death at its finest. Jesus chose to carry that cross for you. Each and every year as a church, I love going all the way back, our founding pastor, coach, every Palm Sunday we stop and we remember what the cross means for you and for me. The sacrifice that Jesus would make. Jesus, who was there at the beginning of time, at the dawn of creation, would step out of heaven into your story, into my story, to offer salvation and peace and hope and eternal life. Jesus in the garden, he began by sweating drops of blood, but he began to bleed from other places for you and for me. And this morning we're going to spend a few minutes talking about the seven places that Jesus bled from, and the significance for you and for me. It started as he's being led down by guards to where he'd be beaten. They took a crown of thorns and they placed it upon his head, pushing thorns that went up to 3 inches deep into his skull, and blood began to pour down his head onto his shoulders. And if you think about the wrestle that you and I face in our everyday lives, the thoughts that go through our head, the things that we think that we wish we didn't, the anxiety and the worries that flood our mind at times, did you know that you can have freedom from those because Jesus chose to bleed from his own head, that you and I can have peace that passes all understanding, as Scripture would tell us? There's peace in your mind. There's forgiveness for the things that you and I have thought, because Jesus chose to bleed from his head. Next, they tied Jesus to a stake, and after the crown of thorns was driven into his head, they began to beat him. And there's so much beauty in this horrible moment that is happening, because Scripture is actually in Isaiah would prophesy that Jesus was bleeding, that you and I could actually experience healing in our lives. Jesus had to bleed for you and for me, and they took this thing called a cat of nine tails. It was a whip beyond horrible imagination. They began to beat Jesus 39 times, and most humans could not even survive the beating he was enduring. His back was torn up and it was bleeding. I think about this so many times in my life. I've turned my own back on Jesus, walking away from the grace and the mercy that he's offered me. Turning my back on the calling that he has for me. Turning my back on the things he's asked me to do, the people that he's asked me to love. And I don't know what you turned your back on in your life, but Jesus had his back beaten that you and I could be forgiven for those moments. He chose to have his back torn open that your back can be whole. That whatever your back is, whatever person you've walked away from, whatever time after time, maybe like you and me, have walked away from Jesus and what he has for our lives, he bled from his back that you and I could have forgiven forgiveness for those moments. He bled from his head and from his back, and then they took the hands that Jesus once held his mother's hands when he was a child. The hands that had just days before knelt down and washed the disciples' feet. The hand that had reached out and grabbed Peter as he sank beneath the waves. The same hand that would help the woman up who is being accused of adultery and that they were threatening to stone her. That hand that lifted that woman up. The same hand that prophesied and that healed and that spoke and that taught and that unrolled the scroll in the temple. The same hand that was there at the beginning of creation. It was heaven's heart. Human hand standing there. They took that hand and they stretched it wide. They drove one nail into his hand. And I can't help but think that the things that my hands have done. Jesus bled from his hands because my hands are unclean. I could never earn my way to salvation. I could never earn my way to heaven because of the things that my hands have done. But your Savior Jesus, he decided to have his hands stretched wide, and one by one, they began to stretch him across this wooden tree, driving nails into his hands that you and I could walk in purity once again. I don't know what your hands have done, but you can experience forgiveness today because of what Jesus has done. They nailed his hands into that tree, and they stretched his feet down as far as they possibly could. Imagine the pain hanging from that tree. Now they're driving nails through his feet. I know it's graphic, but it's holy. The same feet that walked the earth that he formed. The same feet that carried the good news from the city after city. The same feet that walked with Mary Magdalene in the garden after he raised from the dead. The same feet that stepped out of heaven in the stairway into our lives. Those feet stretched across the journey. And I know where my feet have carried me. I know the things that I've run away from, the times that I've run away from God asking me to love people or to share the good news. I know where my feet have carried me into sin at times in my life. But did you know that you can have freedom today and forgiveness of your sins because Jesus chose to bleed for his feet? Finally, as Jesus is hanging on that cross, hours into this excruciating death, somehow still managing to hang on to life. And can I tell you today that he wasn't going to die until he gave up his life, because it wasn't life that was holding on to him, it was him that was holding on to life. The Romans there standing, watching him, he breathes his last breath, finally releasing life into the hands of death, but just for 3 days. They reach up to see if he's still alive. Surely he couldn't be. They take a spear, they drive it into his side, and out of his side flows blood and water. I often think about the things that I carry inside of myself. The envy that I have. The impure thoughts, the greed that lives inside of me, the hatred that I've had towards people, the unforgiveness that I carry in my heart. Did you know that you can have forgiveness of that because Jesus chose to take the wound in his side that you might have healing in yours? Yeah. No matter what you've carried in here today, no matter how far you've run, no matter what you've done, no matter what you're holding on to, today I can tell you that Jesus was pierced in his side. Scripture would say he's pierced for our transgressions, meaning that every sin that you've ever thought or carried, any evil thing in our heart can be forgiven. Because of what Jesus did in that moment. These places where Jesus bled from. 1 Peter chapter 3 would tell us that it was Jesus making a sacrifice for you and I so that we would be right with God. I'll tell you today that you can have a right relationship with God because of what Jesus did. Nothing you and I could have ever done. No striving, no earning, no giving, no running, nothing could get to the Heavenly Father except for the sacrifice that Jesus made. And it's graphic, as I said, but it's holy. It was a second chance. It was a moment when Jesus bled for you and for me. And today, we're going to celebrate that together. As you came in today, you were handed a black piece of paper just like this one. Now, Christ Fellowship is one of my favorite moments of the entire year as a church, because what we're going to do is we're going to write the things that have held us back from the life that God has for us. We're going to take that piece of paper and we're going to nail it to the tree. You may be here today and you've walked in with sin in your life, and you just know there's something there that's holding you back from this life that you know God has for you. I want to encourage you to write that down. We're going to nail it to the cross today because there's forgiveness for you. Maybe there's a burden or anxiety. Maybe it's depression. Something that is literally keeping you awake at night. What I described earlier, that your mind could have peace that passes understanding. You don't remember the last time that you slept through the night or that you stopped worrying. You know you can have peace today in Jesus' name. We're going to write that down and we're going to nail it to the tree. Maybe it's a person we haven't been able to forgive. And today, it's time to release the chains that are actually holding us back and offer forgiveness for the person who harmed us, just like our Savior did. For Judas and for Peter and the disciples that walked away. Finally, maybe you're here today and there's somebody that desperately needs to know Jesus. My sister Leanna, she just knew the love that Jesus has for her. She just knew how much he cared for her. If she would just lift her hands in worship, if she would just accept his grace and his mercy, her name's going on my card.
that God can still make a way.
So I'm going to nail this to the tree. The team's going to begin to lead us in worship. And I want to invite you, when you're ready, to stand up and come down front. We have nails and hammers. We have people to help you today if you can't hold that hammer. We're going to nail these things to the tree, and we're going to continue in worship today. Our Savior Jesus. mercy of Jesus. Guys, I'm going to tell you this. Somebody in your life needs to hear the love of Jesus. Somebody in your life needs to hear the message of the grace and the gospel of Jesus. There's no better time than this week to invite somebody to a Good Friday service on Friday night at 7 p.m. right here at Trinity. Or maybe it's Sunday morning at 9:30 and 11:30. On your way out today, all of us should have 2 or 3 invites in our back pockets at all time. Our Starbucks barista, if you're not fasting Starbucks like my wife, that's all right. You can go cheat one time this week and invite your barista, all right? Maybe you're at the gym. You have your things in the person. George, you got some people at your gym. You need an invitation to church. I know people in our businesses need invitations to church this week to hear the love and the message of Jesus. But God, thank you for everything you've done today. God, I pray that you seal up every single person who's come forward to nail something to the cross. God, I pray that you would go out before them today. God, bring peace, bring provision. God, I pray that you bring healing in every circumstance, because I know that you can, and I know that you will. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Church, I love you so much. We'll see you right back here on Friday night and on Sunday morning.